بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. All praise be to Allah, the master of the day of judgment. And peace and blessings be upon our beloved messenger, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dear brothers and sisters, welcome to your program, The Choice, with me, Hatim al-Absalam, and my beloved Sheikh al-Mu'tasim al-Ma'wali. We salute you all with the salutation of the people of paradise. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, Sheikh?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah.
How's everything?
Doing great.
Alhamdulillah. It's an honor to have you again on the show.
It's my honor.
And I'm sure today's topic is going to be very fruitful.
Inshallah.
Just to remind our listeners that they can call us during the show at any point of time. They can share their experience, they can share their point of view, whether they agree with us or disagree. The theme of our program is that we give you two choices. You decide on which one to take, whether you take both of them or you take one of them. It's up to you. The numbers to call is 24602058, 24602058. The show is going to be repeated in the evening at 7 p.m. And the next day you will find the show or the episode on the SoundCloud at Oman Radio. So you can, whenever you miss the show, you can listen to it later on the SoundCloud. So, Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim, the topic of today is lawful
versus unlawful.
Unlawful. Al-halalu wal-haram.
Inshallah.
And this is a very important topic, but we need to clarify to our listeners why we have chosen this particular topic in this season.
Okay, I think this topic, as you just introduced, is a very important and essential topic because it touches everything in our life. So everything in our life is governed by rules and regulations, basically by halal and haram, or what we call by lawful and unlawful, whether it be at school, at workplace, even at our house. We have regulations and rules with ourselves and with our children as well. And on the religious level, everything in our life, every action is also governed by regulations. So as you know, Islam is a comprehensive religion. So every single incident in our life is covered by one of the five legal rulings. So it is either obligatory what we do, or it is just recommended, or it is lawful, or it is disliked, or it is prohibited to commit in the first place. So this is one reason. And the other reason, which is not less important than this, is that people are not aware of the danger of the unlawful. They might commit unlawful due to ignorance, for example, or they know in the first place it is unlawful, but they are not aware of the severe consequences of committing the unlawful things. And as many of the listeners know, that sins in Islam are of two types.
Yes,
we have major sins, we have as well minor sins. And the major sins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made severe punishment for those who insist on committing a major sins. We have verses in the Holy Quran threatening those who insist on committing the major sins.
Can you give us some examples of these major sins?
For example, insisting on lying, backbiting, cheating, deceiving people, fornication, for example, this false testimony as an example. These are major sins. However, some scholars said all sins are major. There is nothing such minor sins. And this opinion is held by Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father, because he said every single sin we commit against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a major. He said we shouldn't look at the sin itself. We should look at the one who are sinning against. We are sinning, we are disobeying the Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why there was a severe consequence, severe punishment in the hereafter for those who are committing these sins. Of these verses, I do remember now the Almighty saying in Surah Al-Jinn, وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَإِنَّ لَهُ نَارَ جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أَبَدًا. Whoever disobeys Allah and His messengers, he will suffer from the hellfire, and therein they shall dwell forever. So, and the verse, interestingly enough, didn't make a distinction between Muslim or non-Muslim.
So whoever
the verse
those
is
things.
Crystal clear that whoever disobeys Allah and His messengers without repentance, he will suffer from the hellfire. He will be living forever. He will
eternity.
Be dwelling forever eternally in the hellfire.
Yes.
So that's why we decided to shed some light on this issue, to raise the awareness of people regarding the lawful and the unlawful matters.
Now,
we will try to mention advantages of practicing lawful things versus the disadvantages of committing the unlawful things.
Now, this whole concept of lawful and unlawful is about regulations.
True.
And regulations is constraining our freedom.
True.
Now, what is this concept of freedom?
Okay, freedom is a fancy word, actually. You hear it all the time from different people, from different backgrounds. And in fact, freedom is a global right. Nobody
yes.
doubts that. And even it is acknowledged by Islam, the Islam guarantees the freedom of practicing one's religion.
Yes.
I do remember I was a few months back in Uganda. I was invited to give a talk in a church.
Mashallah.
The pastor called me to come to the stage and give a talk in the church. From the things that I mentioned, that Islam is there to guarantee the religious freedom. And we find that in the very first verse in which jihad, which is the most misunderstood concept in Islam, the very first verse in which jihad in its physical sense was legislated, mentioned the purpose of jihad, and that is to protect the religious freedom. To protect the religious freedom.
So people should have the right to practice whatever religion they like.
True. And that is not confined to Islam from this verse. The verse says, وَلَوْلَا دَفْعُ اللَّهِ النَّاسَ بَعْضَهُمْ بِبَعْضٍ لَهُدِّمَتْ صَوَامِعُ وَبِيَعٌ وَصَلَوَاتٌ وَمَسَاجِدٌ. Basically, the verse mentioning the purpose of jihad, that is to protect these places of worship. And interestingly enough, he mentioned the mosque at the very last, at the end of the verse.
Yes.
So he mentioned the Christian churches, for example,
the
Jewish synagogues, and at the end he mentioned
the mosque.
So yes. Islam isn't only about this faith. It is there to protect the religious freedom, whoever they are. And this is clear in the Holy Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the Prophet Muhammad in the very famous chapter, Surah Al-Kafirun. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the chapter of disbeliever, لَكُمْ دِينُكُمْ وَلِيَدِينَ. To you is your religion, and to me is my religion.
Yes.
And the verse, the other verse in the second chapter of the Holy Quran, لَا إِكْرَاهَ فِي الدِّينَ. There is no compulsion
in religion.
In religion.
Yes.
So, but however, we find a practical example beside these theories. We find practical example in Islamic Sharia or Islamic law. We find the freedom or the free choice is there in every single contract we make in our daily life, in every transaction we practice in our daily life. And there is no financial interaction or transaction unless we find the agreement or the consent or the free choice of both parties.
Yes.
So the choice or the freedom is a prerequisite, is a prerequisite for for every transaction to take place. Even in the marriage, for example, the Prophet, peace be upon him, is reported to have dissolved a marriage contract because the woman came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and complained that this marriage took place without her consent, without her agreement. So the Prophet Muhammad dissolved this contract. So that emphasizes, puts more emphasis on this concept, the concept of freedom. In terms of financial transaction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَكُمْ بَيْنَكُمْ بِالْبَاطِلِ إِلَّا أَن تَكُونَ تِجَارَةً عَنْ تَرَاضٍ مِّنْكُمْ, which means roughly translating, O you who have believed, don't consume one another's wealth except it is a business
transaction,
a transaction, a lawful transaction by mutual consent. Yeah.
Okay, now there is a theory going around the entire world that about the total freedom. Mm-hmm. Is there such a thing as total freedom?
Actually, many people hold this notion, unfortunately, that they are totally free and they can do whatever they wish. And they themselves drive, for example, their car without driving license, for example. Mm. Or they allow themselves to cross the red light, for example. Mm. Or drive on the wrong side. So there is nothing such total freedom in life, let alone in the religion. So nobody is allowed to assault the honor of somebody else, or to, for example, hurt somebody else claiming that he is totally free. No, your freedom ends when the other's freedom starts. Your freedom, you are free as long as you don't hurt others.
Yes.
You are free as long as you don't go against the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes. Because He is your creator, He is your sustainer, He is the all-knowing, the all-hearing. So the ultimate lawgiver is Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He knows best. He knows us, basically, best than what we know of ourselves. He knows us best than we do.
Then why do we always put ourselves in this illusion that we can be total free?
I think this goes back to the arrogance, to the ego in ourselves. We try to show that we are in a high level, and there is no superiority over us. We try to show us that we are the best, and there is no authority over us. While in fact, as I just mentioned, the total authority is to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is the one who created us, and He is the all-knowing, the all-hearing, the all-wise, the all-aware. And He should have the ultimate authority, just like Almighty God says, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقَ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Should He not know what He created? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we should be humble before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should be down to earth before Almighty God subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful, as I said, is all merciful, entirely merciful, as we find that at the outset of every chapter in the Holy Quran, apart from the chapter of repentance. We find every chapter is started with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Yes. In the name of Allah, the entirely merciful, the especially merciful. And out of Allah's mercy is that He sent down to us a guidance. That is the Holy Quran. And the example of that, when we buy something, electronic thing or electronic device or a car or whatever it is, usually we find manual instruction, manual or user manual with that thing. And that manual tells us what we should do, what we should practice with this device,
yes,
and what we should refrain from,
yes,
what we should avoid, basically. So if you do it the same way as it was instructed in the manual, you will get the best of it, you will take advantage of it. But on the contrary, if you violate these instructions, these rulings, you might get yourself hurt, you might damage this device. This is the example of the manual that we have, the Holy Quran, the divine manual. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this manual to follow, not only to just recite in a tentative way. We should follow it, we should recite it attentively. And that is clear when we recite the Holy Quran. There's a verse in the Holy Quran telling us the purpose of revealing the Holy Quran. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. This is a blessed book we have revealed to you. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. In order for them to
contemplate
over its verses. وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And in order for those who have intellect to be reminded by these verses. By contemplating over the verses of the Holy Quran, pondering on its verses, we can know what is lawful and what is unlawful. Then we can follow what is lawful and avoid what is unlawful, and we will have the happiness, the ultimate happiness, both in this life and in the hereafter.
It is very sad when you mentioned the concept of the instruction manual,
okay,
whether it is for the devices or for the human being, which is the final revelation, which is the Quran. When we don't follow the instruction manual and everything goes wrong, we blame the manufacturer. That
true.
It is the fault of God.
True.
And this is not something wise to do, because
true,
we are the ones to be blamed.
True.
Because the instructions were clear.
Precisely.
But we willingly decided not to follow these instructions. So how dare we are
to violate the instructions.
We violate the instructions, and then we question Allah for the consequences that happen, whether in this life or in the hereafter.
When we are in good situation, we forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But when we are in a bad situation, we blame Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Yes.
While in fact, we are told there in the Holy Quran, and we are reminded in the Holy Quran in more than one place, that this is an instruction, this is a book of guidance, and you should follow it. Otherwise, you will go astray. Just like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُم مِّنِّي هُدَى فَمَنِ اتَّبَعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا يَضِلُّ وَلَا يَشْقَى وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَى وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى. Which basically means, and if there should come to you guidance from me, then whoever follows my guidance will neither go astray in this world nor suffer in the hereafter. And whoever turns away from my remembrance, indeed he will be depressed. He will have depressed life or miserable life. Actually, yesterday I was listening to a recorded episode from Sheikh Khalfan Al-Aysari. May Allah
have mercy on him.
And he mentioned an interesting point. I didn't pay attention to it in the past. And it is clear, and that is because the lack of contemplation. He mentioned that the Holy Quran isn't a book for Muslims only, isn't a guidance to Muslims only.
Yes.
It is rather a guidance to all humans, be they Muslims or they are non-Muslims.
Yes.
And this is mentioned in the second chapter in the Holy Quran, in the chapter or in the verses that are talking about the month of Ramadan, about fasting the month of Ramadan.
Yes.
The Holy Quran says, the Almighty God says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed.
Yes.
هدى للناس, a guidance for mankind. وبينات من الهدى والفرقان, and clear proof of guidance and criterion. So we notice here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say hudan lil-muttaqin or hudan here in this particular verse for Muslims or to
Muslims. To Muslims.
He said hudan lin-nas, guidance to mankind.
Yes.
So every single human could get benefits from the Holy Quran, could take some of the Quranic guidance.
Now one might wonder, why are there so many regulations restricting life? Why couldn't there be a few regulations?
Actually, the allowed things are much more than the prohibited things. This is one thing. This is a conception we should clarify.
Misconception, yeah.
This is a misconception we should clarify later on. So there is nothing such, so many restrictions, so many regulations. Those who say this misconception are deceived, or they are ignorant. And when we come to the unlawful things in Islam, we should know that Islam is the religion of nature. Islam is there to fulfill the original nature, which we call in Arabic al-fitra, the innate nature or the natural disposition. Islam, when he set these rules, these regulations, these laws, he meant to regulate people's life, to regulate the relations between people, not alone between people, even with oneself, to regulate the relation between the human and within his own soul, the regulations, the relation between him and his creator subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Islam, when he put these regulations, he meant to fulfill the needs, the natural needs, the fitra, what we call fitra, in a safe and secure way. So people are created with the desires, are created with love, with the lust, people love
feelings.
For feelings, yes. Emotions, people love by nature money, wealth, they love, they have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instilled in human the love to have sex with the opposite gender and so on and so forth. Islam isn't there, and these rules are not there to deprive us from these desires, from these natural desire, these natural needs. Rather, it is there to organize our life.
Yes.
To let us fulfill these needs in the best way, in the way that is safer, in the way that is more secure, in the way that prevents any harm, either to the society or to the individual itself. Because Islam isn't about only the individual. Islam is all about the society before the individual. So that's Islam has foresight when he puts this legislation. So, for example, when Islam prohibited many practices, that is because the severe consequences, not only the severe consequences in the hereafter, but also in this life. If I want to give an example, I would give the example of marriage.
Yes.
Islam prohibited any relationship out of the marriage framework. He legislated the marriage in order to fulfill this need. But he prohibited the other wrong ways because Islam knew, as a first reason, that the other ways may cause harm to the individual, to the society. And we know that one of the most severe illness in the modern age is that which is called AIDS, which is mainly caused by having sex with other than one's wife or with other than
with more than one partner.
With more than one partner in a wrong way. And the other thing, Islam, when he legislated this, he legislated that in order to guarantee the rights of the wife herself, in order not to be like anything, like any good on the market you take and you
like
return,
a property.
Like any property. And so it is there to protect her
dignity,
her dignity, her financial rights. She has a financial rights from the marriage.
Yes.
And it is there to protect even the children's right. The children have the right of lineage. They should be ascribed to a father and to a mother. They have financial right as well. They have the right to be raised in the best manner, in the best Islamic way.
I think we'll go for a short break and continue the discussion after the break.
Thank you so much.
Ramadan. Muslims across the globe celebrate this with much devotion and sincerity for a prosperous celebration.
Assalamu alaikum everyone. This is Maryam from the US and I just wanted to say Ramadan Mubarak.
Ramadan Kareem.
Ramadan Kareem from Jordan. From the Saudi Arabia. Ramadan Kareem.
Ramadan Kareem from Malaysia.
Ramadan Kareem from Afghanistan.
Ramadan Kareem.
Ramadan Kareem from Slovenia.
Ramadan Kareem.
Ramadan Kareem
from Brazil.
Ramadan Kareem from Australia.
Ramadan Kareem from Paraguay.
Heartwarming wishes on the Nation Station. Radio Sultanate of Oman 90.4 FM.
In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, all praise is due to Allah, Lord of the universe, the most gracious, the most merciful, owner of the day of judgment. You alone do we worship, and you alone we turn to for help. Guide us to the straight path, the path of those on whom you have bestowed your grace, not the way of those who have earned your anger, nor of those who went astray.
In our modern day, values have changed, and many of us became confused with the choices that life has to offer. Join us in this journey. The choices of life that will lead us to an everlasting happiness and will enable us to remain on the straight path. The choice. 2 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. this Ramadan here on the Nation Station.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear listeners, welcome back to your show, The Choice, with me, Hatim al-Absalam, and Sheikh al-Mu'tasim al-Ma'wali. And today we're talking about lawful and unlawful. And we discussed many points at the beginning before the break. And now we're continuing with the topics. So the next point, Sheikh al-Mu'tasim, is what would happen if there are no laws in life?
Okay, dear Hatim. If there are no laws in our life, I think the whole life would be chaos. We would be living basically in chaos and disorder, and we will be resembling the life in the jungle, where each one tries to take the right of the other, tries to kill the other, and
so
simply
the stronger takes the rights of the weak.
While the laws and regulations are there to protect both, to protect the strong and to protect the weak. So life will, without laws, without lawful and unlawful, without these regulations, would be chaos, and this chaos would ruin our life, would destroy our life. And that's why mankind needs laws and regulation in order for the societies to last, to live.
So can you give us some examples of how the life will be chaotic if we don't have these laws? What will happen?
For example, if one assault the honor of others, the honor of others people, that would cause a lot of chaos, a lot of disorder in our life. And nowadays, we find, for example, in many parts of the world that they legislated such things which go against the human nature. For example, we find some countries allowed what's called legislated, what is called the gay marriage or
same-sex marriage.
Same-sex marriage, or allowed the homosexuality between the members of the society,
yes,
which is against the nature. The animals transcend from doing so.
Yes.
Let alone the human being. But this, when the laws goes, or the laws goes against the nature, against the innate nature that Almighty God instilled in our life. So as I said, the society will not last if it is, if we are living without just laws, let's say just laws, and the life would fall apart, the societies would crumble without these laws and regulations.
Yes, that's very right. Now, the difference between man-made law and divine law, because we always get confused between the two. What is divine law and what is man-made law?
Of course, in terms of source, the divine law comes from the Supreme One, from the one who created us, from the one who created this universe in which we live, from the one who knows us better than we know ourselves, from the one who is all aware, who is all knowing, he is all competent over all things. So the source of the divine law is the real law legislator, the ultimate law legislator, who is Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this law is complete, is totally complete. You don't find any flaws within this law. While the man-made law...
Before you continue, and this divine law should be compatible with everybody.
Because it is compatible with the nature.
Yes.
So it is compatible with every human being, because humans have the same nature. So if this law is compatible with the nature, with the innate nature, with the nature that humans are created in, so this law should, the divine law, compatible with all. And if we come to the issue of the man-made law,
yes,
we find the man-made law, the source of the man-made law, is the human experiments. The experiment that humans face day after day. And that's why this kind of law isn't stable.
They keep on changing.
They keep on changing the law from day one to day two, and so on and so forth. For example, what I have just mentioned, the same-sex marriage.
Yes.
It was illegal in some countries, in many countries, but all of a
legal.
Sudden it is legal,
legal.
And you get convicted if you speak ill about those, if you condemn those who practice, who hold this notion, the homosexuality. And this shows you how disordered they are, how confused they are, because they don't have that basic foundation. While here in Islam, or the divine law is compatible totally with the human nature, so you don't find such confusion.
Yes.
And that's why the divine law is stable, and that's why the divine law is compatible with everybody, isn't changing.
Now you would see these man-made laws, like for example the one you just mentioned, is that some societies they accept it,
true,
but other societies they still don't accept,
yeah,
it, maybe within the same boundaries as well,
true,
even the same members of the family, part of the family members would accept it and others, true, would not accept it,
yeah.
But the divine laws are laws from the Creator, who knows what is best for us,
True.
And these laws are compatible with our inner self, and it is easy for us to implement. We don't find ourselves being imprisoned by these laws.
Yeah, I think another factor that leads this man-made law changing from at one time to another time is that it submits to the pressure of the society. So if the society said we want this thing or we don't want this thing, the law
changes.
The law giver or the legislator, the human legislator, will keep changing the laws according to the desire of part of the society, of majority of the society, irrespective of it being compatible with the human nature or not.
A good example of what we are talking about, Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim, is the Sharia law that has never been changed since the inception of Islam 1,400 years ago. It has remained the same.
True.
The rules and regulations are the same. And
flexible. One of the characteristics of Islamic Sharia is that it is flexible. It can adapt with the different circumstances, because within Sharia we have flexible rules.
Yes.
Even the early jurists of Islam, the early fuqaha of Islam, stated that لا ينكر تغير الأحكام بتغير الأزمان والأمكنة. There is nothing wrong with the changing of certain kind of rulings with the change of time or the change of place. We have in Islam two kind of rulings.
Yes.
The rulings in Islam are of two kinds. They are either flexible and or fixed ruling.
Can you give us an example, Sheikh, so that
people
understand?
The flexible ruling, for example, either to pray al-witr 3 rak'ah or 1 rak'ah. Of the flexible rulings is that when you travel, you shorten your prayer. Of the flexible rulings, when you travel, you have the choice whether you fast Ramadan or you break your fasting.
But the core is the same.
The core is the same.
Like, you cannot leave your prayers.
Of course.
You have to pray.
Of course.
But the means, the circumstances will make the ruling flexible.
True.
But the end result is the same. You have to pray. And you have to fast. If you're a traveler, you have to compensate the days that you have missed.
Yeah, of course. And of the fixed ruling, example of that, for example, the inheritance shares.
Yes.
We find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discussed the inheritance or the inheritance in general in the Holy Quran in details. He gave every single one his right.
Yes.
So everyone should have his right, because this thing couldn't make dispute between the members of the society. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that. And he said, interestingly enough, at the end of that verse, تِلْكَ حُدُودُ اللَّهِ. These are the boundaries of Allah.
Yes.
وَمِنْ يَتَعَدَّ حُدُودَ اللَّهِ. And he mentioned the severe punishment in the hereafter, that whoever violate these boundaries, these limitations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala set, will experience the severe consequences in the hereafter. He will be burned in the hellfire forever.
We would like to remind our listeners that they can join the discussion with myself and Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim Al-Ma'wali. Our numbers are 2460-2058. You will also find the repetition of this episode in the evening at 7 on the same channel. And you'll find a copy of this episode on the SoundCloud Oman Radio tomorrow, inshallah. So please do call us and tell us what do you think of this topic. Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim, are the laws there to deprive us from our rights, or they are there actually to protect our rights?
Actually, the laws are not there to deprive us from our life. Rather, the second part of the question is correct, because every human being has the right to lead a happy life, has the right to live a comfortable life, a life full of tranquility. And these laws are there to serve this ultimate goal, so there should be rules. There should be rules laid down in order to protect everyone's life and in order to guarantee that everyone will have this tranquil life and no disturbance in his life. And these rules, as I said earlier, were set by the Almighty God, who created the society, who knows the society better than what we do. So these laws, whether we know the wisdom behind them or we don't know the wisdom, they are there for our benefit. And as Muslims, it is worth saying here that as Muslims, we submit to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether we know the wisdom behind this law, behind this being unlawful, or we don't know the wisdom behind it. So we submit because this rule, we refrain from this unlawful, for example, or we practice this lawful thing because the Almighty God who created us has commanded us to do this lawful things or to refrain from this lawful, without having to know what the wisdom behind that. And I can recall, you asked me, Hatim, at the break to mention examples.
Yes, yes.
For each point. So I recall here an example, interesting example. I heard this example when I was in the UK. That is the example, in Islam it is illegal. There is a big issue in the West about halal meat, about lawful halal, lawful meat. So because there are certain shops Muslims can buy halal meat or lawful meat from. So there is a big issue, an issue of halal. Why is this meat halal? And why is that unlawful meat? Why are Muslims so special in this regard? And
why can't they eat like everybody else?
True. Some scholars did a research on this regard, and they come out with some interesting outcomes.
Yes.
They said it is well established in medicine that most of the germs and harmful bacteria that cause diseases and severe illnesses are running in our blood throughout our body. And if you eat the meat, if you eat the flesh, and the blood is there, didn't
without,
get out.
Without the blood being drained.
Yeah, without the blood being drained and being get rid of, you eat these harmful things. But when Islam, why are we asked to slaughter the animal in this particular way? This scientific research suggests that when you cut the front parts of the neck, the brain gets a lack of blood. So it sends signals. We know in the Islamic way of slaughtering the animals, we cut only the front parts of the neck, the vessels that are at the front parts of the neck, and we don't cut the spinal column.
Yes.
Or the bone, or what's called the bone marrow, which connects the
scalp to the spine.
Exactly. So we don't cut that. So the scholar said when you slaughter the animal in this particular way, the brain gets lack of blood, so it sends, it starts sending signals to the other parts of the body, to the heart, to the other limbs of the body, and the body starts sending blood towards the head or towards the brain. But it pumps
more blood. The muscles they contract,
shrink.
They shrink, and then they push down. They push up the blood towards the brain.
Exactly. So when the blood gets to the neck part, when it gets out of the body, and the brain keeps sending more signals for the rest of the body to pump more blood, but the blood keeps going out of the of the body, and by the death of that animal, the animal becomes pure of the blood and these harmful germs and so on and so forth. And this is, as I said, a sort of scientific miracles in the Holy Quran and the prophetic traditions. Because the Holy Quran, it is the Holy Quran who forbade us from eating this kind of flesh that is illegally killed.
So actually, it's even beneficial for non-Muslims to eat the halal meat. It is good for them.
This is actually what we found in the UK. We found Muslim restaurants are visited by so many non-Muslims. They like halal food.
Yes.
And they say themselves, we feel that halal food is more clean, is more pure.
Yes.
We find them queue in the Muslim restaurants, demanding, ordering Muslim food, Muslim halal food.
Alhamdulillah.
And so, as I said, this is a fulfillment of Allah's promise. We find in the Holy Quran, in more than one place, the Holy Quran tells us that there are secrets which will be unveiled in the future. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سَنُرِيهِمْ آيَاتِنَا فِي الْآفَاقِ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَهُمْ أَنَّهُ الْحَقِّ. Surely we will show them our signs, our miracles in the horizons and within themselves until it becomes visible, until it becomes obvious to them that this is the truth.
And these are the signs that are being revealed every single day with modern technology and modern science.
Yeah, of course, in all aspects of our life, I believe that every single aspect of our life is touched by what's called the scientific miracles. And this is the language which we could address and which we could have dialogue with non-Muslims, because it is the age of science. The Quranic miracles are of different parts. We have the linguistic miracles, which served at the beginning, at the outset of the prophetic mission. We have the legislative miracle. We have now what's called the scientific miracles. And these things, even non-Muslims can doubt, because they are established, they are well established, they don't doubt the scientific facts.
If you only look at the law of inheritance,
okay.
Yeah, it is mentioned in one chapter.
Yeah, in chapter of Nisa,
chapter of women,
the fourth chapter,
and it is described in details, which covers all aspects of inheritance.
True.
While in the man-made law, you would
volumes.
Find volumes and volumes and volumes of civil law of inheritance.
True. Which it is in the Quran summarized in very precise and accurate way.
Yes. So these are the miracles that we're talking about. Now,
legislative miracles.
There is a misconception, Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim. I know we touched upon it in the beginning. This misconception is there with Muslims and with people of different faith. They say that a lot of unlawful things are more than the lawful things.
Yeah.
That our life is full of restrictions. Everything is haram, 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 haram. So this is very common, even among Muslims. They say that you people are making our religion very difficult.
Yeah.
Everything is forbidden. We can't enjoy ourselves. We can't have a peaceful life because of these prohibitions.
Guys are complicating our life. And,
so is this true or is this...
As you said, it is sadly that many people holds this notion that halal is less than haram and unlawful is more than lawful. And this goes back to the ignorance. And ignorance is the cause of all problems, most problems. While in reality, the opposite is true. The opposite is true, that is lawful is more than unlawful. And we find this meaning in the Holy Quran. The ultimate lawgiver, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, says, هو الذي سخر لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. هو الذي سخر لكم ما في الأرض جميعا. It is Allah who subject everything to you, O mankind. And there is another verse in which Almighty Allah says, أَلَمْ تَرَوْا أَنَّ اللَّهَ سَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْ. Don't you see, O people, that Allah has made subject to you whatever in the heavens and whatever in the earth, and He bestowed upon you His favors, whether it is apparent favors or an apparent favor. So, and on the other hand, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't make unlawful unless there is detrimental element on that unlawful things. Yes. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it unlawful to protect us, to protect ourselves as individuals, and to protect the societies as a whole. While the default rule is that everything, as we just quoted these verses, everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created in this, on this earth, is lawful. On this earth or inside this earth is lawful to us. We can consume it, we can use it, unless there is exception, unless there is a textual proof, textual evidence from Quran and Sunnah, or there is a sound analogical reason. For example, it is harmful to people, to mankind, to the earth, to the animals. In this case, it will be made unlawful. So unlawful is the exception to the rule.
Okay, give us some examples of
drinks. Mm-hmm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made all kind of drinks, juice,
anything lawful. Anything liquid is lawful.
Is lawful. This is the default ruling.
Yes.
And He only prohibited that which might cause harm to us.
Yes.
For example, alcoholic drinks, mm-hmm. because they change the mind, they change the behavior, the human behavior.
Yes.
When one loses his mind, mm-hmm. he might go astray, he might misbehave, he might hurt other people, his fellow brothers in humanity. This is the only thing. Otherwise, all...
And also blood.
Also blood, for drinking example. Blood, yes. Poison, for example, because these are harmful things. Okay. So the default ruling, when we are faced with something new, we should assume
it the is lawful.
Lawfulness, if we can say, mm-hmm. on that thing, unless it is well established, it becomes well established to us, this has some harmful element in it.
Yes.
So this is one example.
Thank you very much for that example, Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim. Now, there is a very fine or thin line between halal and haram, what is lawful and what is unlawful. And many people get confused in these things which are in the middle.
True.
So how can we tackle this?
As you said, many people, we face, of course, in our life, many issues that are new to us. Some issues we know the legal rulings on them, because simply they are mentioned in the Holy Quran, for example, or the Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, has clarified the rulings of them in the prophetic tradition. But we come across in our daily life things that we have never come across before, and we need the legal rulings on that. They are on that state misconception, or they are in that state, we are doubtful about them at that state. And when we come to the doubtful things, we should take precautionary measures. We should stop, we should withhold, we shouldn't jump and commit that doubtful thing. And this is derived from the prophetic guidance, from the prophetic direction, which is narrated on the authority of An-Nu'man ibn Bashir, one of the great companions, may Allah be pleased with him, who said, Al-halalu bayin, wal-haramu bayin. Lawful is clear and unlawful is clear. وَبَيْنَهُمَا أُمُورٌ مُتَشَابِهَةٌ. And between them are matters that are doubtful, meaning not clear.
Yes.
So many of the people the continuity of the hadith that many of the people don't know whether it is lawful or unlawful. So whoever leaves it to protect his religion and his honor, then he will be safe. And whoever falls into something from them, then he soon will fail into the unlawful. Just like someone grazes his animals around a sanctuary, he will soon wind up, or he will soon end up in it. Indeed, for every king is a sanctuary, and indeed Allah's sanctuary is what he made unlawful. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made things lawful and unlawful, but because of us being ignorant in some circumstances, we get hesitant whether this is lawful or unlawful. And in that case, we should refrain, we should stop. دع ما يريبك إلى ما لا يريبك. Leave what is doubtful to you to that which is not doubtful to you.
So to be on the safe side.
To be on the safe side. And we are recommended by our scholars, our sheikh, all the time to take the precautionary opinion. For example, when we are faced with the two options, we should take the one that is safer. I remember Sheikh Saeed Al-Qannoubi, under whom I studied for a few years, always when we are doubtful about something, he said, this is more precautionary, so stick to the most precautionary opinion or practice.
Yes. Now, are there any categories of the unlawful, Sheikh Al-Mu'tasim?
Some scholars, we find that in the Hanafi school of law, the school of the great Imam Abu Hanifa, they divided the haram into two categories. That which is strongly prohibited, strongly not recommended in the Islamic Sharia, which we call usually al-haram. This is the first category, where one is punished if he committed this haram thing, and he is on the other hand rewarded if he left this haram thing. This is the first category. And the second category, as for the second category, it is what we call usually al-makruh. In the Hanafi school, they call it makruh tahrimi. Makruh tahrimi, which is slightly disliked, which yes. is slightly prohibited, not strongly prohibited, where one is rewarded if he leaves it, while on the other hand he isn't punished if he commit that kind of makruh or that kind of haram, which is makruh tahrimi, which is makruh basically. And what I wanna say here, that whether it is of the first part or of the second part, whether it is makruh, which is strongly makruh, or slightly makruh, whether it is unlawful, whether it is haram, or it is just makruh, the matter of the true believer is to refrain from all that. This is, we find the righteous predecessor, the Prophet's companions, wouldn't question the Prophet when the Prophet asked them to refrain from a particular thing. They wouldn't ask him, is this totally prohibited or slightly prohibited? So if it is totally prohibited, they would say, okay, we will leave it. And if it is slightly, just slightly prohibited, if it is makruh, there is no harm in committing it. No, this is not the practice of the Prophet's companion.
I think we have a call.
Okay, we will resume after the call.
Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam.
How are you, brother?
Yes, hi. How are you?
Fine, thank you.
How are you, Sheikh Hatim?
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Alhamdulillah.
Sheikh Mu'tasim, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, I'm fine. How are you?
Alhamdulillah.
Yes, brother. Ramadan Kareem. And have you been listening to the show?
Yes. Actually, not the whole, not from the start.
Yes.
I've listened to parts of it only.
Okay. Tell us what
I want to make a comment about something.
Yes.
Something similar to freedom. Another concept that has long been abused also.
Yes.
Just like freedom, which is critical thinking.
Critical thinking.
Yeah.
Yes.
Actually, many people actually when it comes to halal and haram, they try to employ this concept of critical thinking in their debate of what they want to make lawful or what they want to make unlawful. They think that with just trying to think critically about what their minds accept, and then they say, for example, like hijab. Actually, I've had a debate with a friend of mine about hijab, and he said that to me, critically thinking, this is not really something unlawful. Just applying this critical thinking skill that he has, without referring to Quran, without referring to Hadith, without referring to, without even having the capacity actually to judge this. And this is really important. I think it's really important also to shed light on critical thinking as well as freedom.
So, brother, what do you mean to say is that they forget about the regulation, the clear regulations, whether it is in the Quran or in the Sunnah, and they follow only their critical thinking?
Yeah, this is merely critical, what they call critical thinking, but I think it's not critical thinking. It's
following the desires, their own desires.
Yeah, it's only following desires. Mm. And you can listen to this and you can hear this from different people. And they say, logically speaking, this is what they introduce the saying with, logically speaking, I don't think that this is unlawful because of what my mind tells me, okay, which is not actually scientific at all. Because if you want to judge something, if you want to give a judgment about a thing, you need to have the means in order to give a judgment, to give a legislation, in order to give a law about something, whatever it is.
Yes, very, very, very valid point, inshallah. We will try our level best to, if we have time, to discuss this point, brother. Thank you so much.
By the way, who is with us?
Hatem,
this is your job.
Abdullah Rawahi. MashaAllah. Thank you for calling,
thank
Abdullah,
you.
And thank you for this very
thank
important
you,
point.
Thank you. Brother Abdullah has made a very interesting point, which is relevant to our reality nowadays.
Yes.
Because we find nowadays, sadly, there is a group of people who try to give precedence to the mind, to the intellect, over the revelation itself. And as a matter of fact, there is a rule stated by the early Islamic jurist that there is no consideration for the mind when there is explicitly mentioned to an Islamic ruling, whether in the Quran or in the prophetic tradition.
I think we have another call.
Okay.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
How are you, brother?
Alhamdulillah. How are you, brother Hatem?
Fine, thank you. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen.
I think I am used to this voice.
Is this...
How are you, brother Matafam?
I'm fine, alhamdulillah.
Is this brother Munir?
Yeah. Brother Munir.
How are you, brother Munir? How's everything?
Alhamdulillah, everything is okay.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's always a pleasure to hear your voice and your valid points.
It's my pleasure to listen to you, but... It's always, I mean, you are intriguing us by your controversial topics.
Alhamdulillah,
I mean,
alhamdulillah.
Yeah, this topic
Hatem always
and
gets
and
me trapped.
I have also listened to Brother Abdullah Rawahi,
yes.
And he raised a very good point, really,
yes.
About critical thinking. And I really wonder, I mean, people, I mean, he said that people question things legislated by Islam, but on the other hand, I don't see those people using this approach or this means of, as they call it, critical thinking. They don't use it for man-made laws.
Yes,
true.
I mean, let's give real examples.
Yes.
I mean, those people, I mean, picking up on some, let's say, Islamic laws like wearing hijab, having a beard, listening to music, and so on. But they don't question the rules made by people. Let's give real examples. I haven't heard anyone in the country questioning the amount, the fine that is set by Royal Oman Police. Like, or if you exceed the limit,
yes.
If you exceed the limit set by the police, like 120 or whatever you will be fined. Mm. Like you pay around 10 riyals, and for other amounts you pay such and such. Mm. But they haven't even those people claiming like they are using critical thinking. They don't question why 5, why not 10, why 10, why not 5, why should we pay this amount? They don't question like man-made rules.
Yes.
And think about other examples. When it comes to religion, they say, okay, let's use critical thinking.
True.
Let's see what's the wisdom behind this.
True.
And if they don't see any apparent wisdom, they reject it.
True.
So this is happening. And our youth nowadays, really, we need to look at this issue. Like, our people now, they are heading to this way.
True.
And we need to find a solution for this.
True.
I mean, I listened to you, Sheikh Mutasim, when you give the example of the medical wisdom behind slaughtering animals. And
yes,
that helped a lot, and helped
True.
Even non-Muslims.
True.
Right?
To appreciate the Islamic rulings.
But we cannot, get all the wisdoms behind things, because these are legislated by Allah.